It's time to add gameplay. In my Minecraft clone, we've created a world that we can interact with, but are we really part of that world? We can't really say so unless we're able to walk around, not just fly around like a spectating ghost. We need to use collision detection and response to make sure our character stays on the ground rather than phasing through. First, we have an axis-aligned bounding box around the player, with the minimum and maximum points defining it. We use this bounding box to find all the blocks that surround a player, with a nested for loop to get within the bounds of each axis. With these blocks, we can move the player towards the target location, and move the player outside if they intersect. But there's a problem. If we move the player across, it will clip into diagonal blocks, stopping the player in its tracks. But we need to check for diagonal blocks, not just adjacent. Otherwise, the player can face the corner of a block and step inside without colliding. The solution to this is separating the collision code into each axis and solving independently. First, we move the player in the y-axis and move it outside if it collides. If the block is below, then we know that the player is on the ground, used for jumping logic. Then we move the player in the x and z-axis respectively, moving the player in each axis again in the case of an intersection with a block. Where do we know for each axis to put the player in case of collision? In my game, I just used the previous location's corresponding x, y, and z coordinate. This works, but it will seem like the block's bounding boxes are too large and moving at extremely high speeds. I will fix this later, but this works well without any other edge cases in normal gameplay to worry about for now. To account for stairs and slabs, we define a variable called max step height, which we reset to 0.5, representing that we can walk up half a block. When checking for collisions in the x and z axes, we can check if we are on the ground, and if the intersecting block's bounding box is at most max step height away in the y axes, then it means we can walk up the block. But just before we do so, we check all the blocks above the player's hitbox for blocks that would get in the way. If there are none, then we can set the Y position of the player on top of the slab. Since the player now truly exists in the world, we need to stop the player from placing the blocks inside themselves. All that needs to be done in the block placing code is to check if the new block would intersect with the player's bounding box, and if so, don't place the block. We can now add various movement options for the player. Sprinting is no different than walking, but faster. When pressing the sprint button, we will continue sprinting until we stop moving. For now, there are no downsides compared to walking, but when we implement survival mode, we can revisit this. Sneaking in Minecraft allows the player to not fall off the edges of a block. To accomplish this, before moving in either the X or Z axis, check if the player is sneaking on the ground. If there are no blocks below the bounding box that are solid, which would be intersected with the axis being moved across, then stop the player from moving. Sometimes you want to get into tight spaces, so we'll add crawling. If the player presses the crawl button, then make the height of the bounding box smaller than the block. Additionally, if the player doesn't have enough space to stand, then force them to crawl until they get more headroom. To swim, we go through each block of the player from top to bottom. And if the block is a fluid, such as water, then quit the search and use the height to calculate the ratio of how deep the player is in fluid. If the player is in fluid, then decelerate relative to the velocity, and allow the player to move up freely when pressing the jump button, rather than waiting for the player to be on the ground first. All the basic movement is done, but we'd like to go a step beyond here. If the player is sprinting outside of a fluid and is colliding with a wall, then we reduce the gravity modifier to add wall running. This allows the player to skip gaps they normally wouldn't in a satisfying way. I'm not sure if I want this mechanic to be available by default, but I think it would make for a great power-up. I tried adding wall jumping, but interfered with normal sprinting. In particular, when you walked up blocks, it would wrongly push you away. For now, I've shelved this idea. But if I can think of a fix in the future, I definitely will add it. At this point, I was satisfied with the progress I made with movement, but I had to delay this video. So I asked you guys again what else I should make for it. And this time you chose the hotbar in Creative Inventory, which was surprising, since at first Falling Sand had quite the head start in votes. The main challenge was to render the block items in a 2D space, which could be done by giving the items a camera separate from that of the UI in the world, to which it rendered the block from a fixed perspective in a draw call. The draw call would have a viewport applied to restrict it to the area of the inventory slot. The downside is that each item with a 3D model requires its own draw call, since it is the same perspective in different areas on the screen. But because there are only a few items on screen, the performance cost isn't too bad, as long as we are diligent not to draw any items that go off screen. A hotbar that only has hard-coded items isn't very useful at all, so I added an item catalog. This is directly inspired from too many, not enough, just enough items, and is at a very basic stage with no filtering or pages since we just don't have that many blocks right now. Clicking on any of the blocks puts in the first available hotbar slot, and with that, our game finally has the very basics of gameplay. After 5 months. Let's look at the comments. Stick around until the end where I'll be talking about the plans for the game and the next steps. You suggested that fluid should intersect through all non-solid blocks, and that also liquid concrete should be added. when I get around to implementing fluid mechanics, this is pretty much what I want to aim for. There are challenges to get there, however. Whether it's implemented through block states or having another nibbled data layer, it is going to complicate the rendering code, and perhaps the generation code. It's an exciting prospect, but it will require an elegant solution. It would be even better if I could implement some sort of fluid mixing system, but let's not make any promises here. Some of you suggested that I take a look at Quantum Developer's procedural crafting system. This approach is quite creative, especially how it takes the player's choices into account, but I would like to actually move away from the grid-based system if possible. Others mentioned an ore dictionary or tag system, and also to look at games like Project Zomboid as well. I'm starting to get a better idea of how to make the right crafting system, but that's for the future. Speaking of Quantum Developer, when I made the community post on water in a memory leak, he gave me a good sanity check that encouraged me to investigate further to fix said leak. My game has been a lot more stable ever since. He also gave me a way to reduce memory usage even further, but I haven't gotten around to that yet. But it's quite substantial and will lead to bug fixes related to water as well as being able to include in more information for use in shaders, such as face normals. If you're interested in voxel developments, you should definitely check them out. When it comes to reducing memory usage, one of you also recommended to look at Verdicium's video on optimization. The important idea behind it was vertex compression and batching, which I do employ, albeit it can be improved. As far as using the GL triangle strip approach, it works very well for him because his terrain was mostly flat and connected. In a voxel world, you often have faces disconnected from each other, so in adding the information needed to express that, you negate the memory savings from using GL triangle strip over GL triangles. This is very scene dependent, however. I asked you guys your thoughts on character design, and the consensus seemed to be that Minecraft's character was spot on, but needed more customization, to take the best of both Java and Bedrock, but without the microtransactions. Many add the praise for Hytale's characters since they have a high resolution while being stylized, although not everyone had the same praise. Frigid's story was controversial, as people liked the inclusion of elbows and knees, the expression of its personality and how it matches the aesthetic of the game, yet some found the character ugly and creepy. What surprised me was the mention of Rana, but I suppose if that early model had animations I would have found it much more appealing. I think that character looks good, but it was a total mismatch from the rest of Minecraft's art style. From this, I can say that the important part is to match the aesthetic of the world, be as customizable as is reasonably possible, and to be well animated to show off personality. Quite the challenge. Now let's talk about the plans for the game. We finally have gameplay now, so our next steps is to get it ready for a pre-alpha release. That means a few things in particular. Implementing an options menu, main menu, as well as saving and loading. I've decided that multiplayer will wait until alpha at the latest. For now, I think it would be better to get the pre-alpha in your hands for playtesting, to see the game for yourself, find bugs, and help me tune it for different systems. The game is nowhere near complete and needs a lot of work to make more optimizations, engine features, modding, multilingual, and texture pack support. We're in this for the long run. Pre-alpha will be extremely buggy and will be completely free to play, since you should get your money's worth, and won't be monetizing the game until alpha. So what will be the stages of development? Pre-alpha will be focused on developing the engine, supporting features that I want in the final game. Alpha will be focused on the survival experience, adding the core game loops and solidifying the identity. Beta will be focused on adding polish to the point where it can be declared out of early access. When the pre-alpha is ready for you to play, I will set up a Discord server where you can join and try it out, alongside sharing your experiences and being able to discuss the game. There is one crucial thing that the game needs before any release, however, and that is a name. A name is intrinsically intertwined with a game's identity, so it's very difficult to come up with one before the identity is even in the game. As such, I will pitch the premise now, and hopefully you can give me inspiration to give the name it will deserve. It has been 10,000 years since the fall of civilization, ravaged by monsters that still roam the earth. In humanity's final days, they created robots to combat them, only for them to be hostile to everything in sight, including you. Whether a survivor or a colonist from another world, you find this world overtaken by nature, ready for it to be rebuilt as you see fit. Build factories, machinery, fight bosses, and engage in mad science to aid you in your adventures to explore the world and uncover the past, the reason for humanity's fall, in hopes that history does not repeat itself. I hope that you find this premise engaging, and that you can help me in finding the right name. I have many things more to say, but I'll leave it here for now. Have a Merry Christmas. Take care. And I'll see you next time.